The topic of my talk is on some algorithmic questions about tilings and cellular automata. So my plan is to describe some technique that I developed a long time ago to prove some questions undecidable concerning cellular automata. And later on, these techniques turned out to be useful also to obtain some results for so-called snake tilings. That explains the snake in the title. I will show direct reductions between these, and as a kind of a small new contribution in this talk, I will show that these proofs can be merged into unified proof that then gives some recursive inseparability results. So let me set the stage first here. So the main object that we use in this talk are Wang tiles. So a Wang tile is just a unit square tile with colored edges. You see here four Wang tiles. And we consider tilings of the plane with a finite number of different tiles, but you have an infinite number of copies of each tile available. So basically a tiling is just an assignment of these unit squares in a regular way on a plane in such a way that neighboring tiles must match in color. So the color in neighboring tiles of the adjacent edges have to have the same color. So that's the local matching condition that's given by the colors of the tiles. So here is an example of part of a valid tiling with these four tiles that I showed you. It's just a 5x5 square, but you see how the colors match everywhere. And now if you look carefully, you see that the colors on the left and right sides are actually identical. The sequence of colors are the same. So you can repeat this 5x5 pattern periodically to get a horizontal strip. And the same is true for the bottom and top rows. So you can actually repeat this 5x5 pattern to get a periodic, fully periodic tiling of the plane. So now we have a very natural decision problem, which was considered already by Hao Wang 50 years ago. This is called the domino problem. So you have you are given this finite set of tiles, and the question is, does it admit at least one valid tiling of the plane? Is it possible to cover the plane, infinite plane, so that this tiling constraints are satisfied? Now, this problem is undecidable. It was proved also almost 50 years ago. But let me just give you a kind of a hint why it might be difficult to do it algorithmically. So first, what would be an obvious attempt for an algorithm to solve this question? So you could try the following. Let's just try to tile bigger and bigger squares. So let's try first, can you tile a 2x2 square with the tiles? Well, if you cannot do the 2x2 square, then certainly you cannot tile the infinite plane, so you can tell no. Then if you can tile, move on to a 3x3 squares, tile, try all possible ways of putting the tiles there, see if you have valid tiling. If not, you can return answer no, and so on. Keep on doing that forever, or until you find a square that you cannot tile. So if your tile set is a negative instance to domino problem, so that it does not admit the tiling of an infinite plane, then it's actually easy to prove that you must have some n such that you cannot tile even an n by n square. So this algorithm, in quotation marks, would be able to return the no answer if your tile set is a negative input instance. But of course, if your tile set is a positive instance and tiles the plane, you will never get any answer out of this algorithm. So it's just a semi-algorithm for non-tileability. So let's try to improve the algorithm a little bit. So let's try to add there the possibility to get the positive answer. So let's do the following. Again, we try to tile bigger and bigger squares. For each n, try all possible ways of putting the tiles in the n by n square. If you cannot tile it properly, return answer no. And if you can tile it properly, and moreover in such a way that the colors on the left and right match and the bottom and top match, as in my previous 5x5 example, then you know that you can return the yes answer, because you have a that your tiles will admit a periodic tiling, so you get a yes answer in that case. All right, so this algorithm returns the no answer whenever tiling doesn't exist and a yes answer whenever a periodic tiling exists. So would it be an algorithm that solves the domino problem? Well, no. It turns out that there are tile sets that fall in the cracks between these yes and no instances. So there exist so-called aperiodic tile sets that do tile the plane, but do so only in non-periodic ways. And so this second attempt also fails in if the input happens to be one of these aperiodic cases. And yes, as I mentioned, this question is in fact undecidable. This was proved by Berger and published in 1966. And actually, as part of the proof, Berger constructed the very first known aperiodic set of Wang tiles. So until that moment, it was conjectured that any tiles that tiles the plane actually tiles periodically also. But so he refuted this conjecture and moreover proved that this domino problem is undecidable. And since then, smaller aperiodic tile sets have been constructed, and the current record holder has 13 Wang tiles. So the smallest known aperiodic set of Wang tiles has 13 tiles. And I should also mention that there have been, in recent years, several new proofs for this Berger's result using different techniques. So it's such a fundamental result that I think it deserves to have also different kinds of proofs. Now, in this proof, I will also use another variant of the domino problem, which is actually much simpler to prove to be undecidable, which I call the finite domino problem. So here again, you are given a finite set of Wang tiles, and now you are interested to know, one of the tiles is so what we call a Planck tile. So here, denoted by lowercase b. So it's a tile that has the same Planck color on all sides. And so now the decision problem is the following. Can you make a valid tiling where you only have a finite number of non-Planck tiles used? So you have this infinite sea of Plancks and then some finite region, finite but non-empty region, where you have non-Planck tiles. And it's actually very easy to see that this is undecidable using the technique, original techniques of Hao Wang. A small remark about these two variants of the domino problem. Notice that the direction of semi-decidability is kind of opposite in these two cases. So in the original domino problem, the negative instances, those tiles that do not tile the plane, are semi-decidable. I actually showed you the semi-algorithm to recognize the tile sets that do not tile the plane. Whereas in the finite version, the positive instances are semi-decidable because you just have to find that finite tiling. Just try all possible ways to make finite tilings until you find a valid one. All right, so this was the setting of the stage for the talk. Now, I want to show two applications of this undecidability of the domino problem in two different fields. So I will first talk about a mathematical model of self-assembly and some decision problems that come up in there. And I show how the domino problem can be used to prove undecidability results in this context. And then I will talk about cellular automata and show some undecidability results that we obtain for cellular automata. So let's first talk about the first application field, which is the self-assembly. So the real-world self-assembly refers to the process in which some small objects like molecules come together, attach to each other, and in this way they grow to form some complex structures. Here are some examples of structures that have been implemented and actually built in laboratory using the process of self-assembly. There's a perfect cube and dihedron. And this is a very much studied area right now because of the prospects that it has for building small devices, nanoscale devices. So in nanotechnology, you basically have these two approaches. You can try to do top-down building of miniature devices by so-called lithography techniques. But then you have this bottom-up approach, where you, which is the self-assembly is an example of. So you try to design, choose the molecules in such a way that by the laws how they attach to each other, they are forced to build the structure that you want, the kind of shape that you want. And another application would be the computation by self-assembly. So in 94, you probably all know that Len Adelman demonstrated how the self-assembly can be of DNA molecules can be used to solve some instances of hard computational problems. All right, so to study self-assembly mathematically, we introduced some theoretical model for it. And such a model was proposed by Len Adelman and Erik Winfrey in the late 90s, and it is based exactly on Wang tiles. So here we model the molecules by tiles. The colors on the edges model the rules under which they attach to each other, the molecules. And so we place these tiles on the plane. We say that two tiles stick to each other if they have a matching color. And so as before, we have only a set of finite number of different tiles, because in self-assembly we only use finite number of different molecules. On the other hand, we have an infinite supply of each tile, because in self-assembly we cannot control the exact number of molecules, how many you have participating in the process. So you just put a bunch of them in your test tube. So it's exactly the setup of our domino tilings. And so the idea is now that you have these molecules floating around and they start sticking to each other. So whenever you have a tile, a new tile can attach to it if the colors match. This is a non-deterministic process, so there are several ways how this can proceed. New tiles just keep on attaching if they match. Now, we can imagine different setups in situations when a new tile tries to attach to a place where it has more than one neighbor. And I will consider two different models. In the first one, which I call the strong sticking rules, I require that a tile can attach to a place if and only if it matches with all the neighbors that are already present in the assembly. So here, in this place, I could, for example, put tile C because it matches in both sides. And then we have the other choice, which I call the weak sticking rule, where I say that the tile can attach to this assembly if there is even one side that matches. So for example, in the same place here, I can now put tile B because it matches in the yellow color to this left neighbor, but it does not need to match to the other neighbor then. All right, and so the idea is that you start and you are interested in the structures that can be built in this way for a given Wang tile set. Actually, in the original model by Winfrey, it was more general than these two sticking rules that I use here. What he did was that he introduced a weight, a kind of a strength for each color, and in his model a tile could attach if the sum of the strengths on the sides exceeded some given threshold value. So it's a more general model than what I discuss here. Well, of course, this kind of tiling model is a huge simplification of the real-world self-assembly. I mean, molecules are not squares, usually, even though you can make square-shaped molecules. But this model, even though it's a huge simplification, it's already complex enough to capture a kind of the geometrical complexity of at least two-dimensional self-assembly. And it's already powerful enough to allow, for example, universal computation. And of course, what I do here is that I will prove undecidability results for this model. So if you get some undecidability result for this simple model, then of course the same questions about the real-world self-assembly systems would be at least as difficult, so they have to be undecidable as well. So what kind of algorithmic questions naturally arise in this model? So usually we are interested in designing the molecules so that they self-assemble into some desired shape. So a kind of a natural decision problem is to ask, does a given tileset assemble into some unique shape? Not necessarily, no matter what non-deterministic choices you make. Also, people have looked at complexity questions, like what is the minimum number of different tile types that are needed to build some particular shape, let's say square of size n, how many different tiles you need. And the question that I will consider here is the termination problem. So the question, given a set of Wang tiles, can they keep on adding more and more into the pattern so that the pattern grows forever, or does this process necessarily terminate at some moment so that no new tiles can be attached? So that's the termination problem. I call the pattern a terminal assembly if no new tiles can be attached to it. So the process terminates there. And I say that the tileset admits unbounded growth if it's possible. I mean, we have these non-deterministic choices, but if it is possible to make the choices in such a way that the process continues forever and it does not reach a terminal assembly. And so we have obvious decision problem. If you give me the set of tiles, does it admit the unbounded growth, or does it always reach a terminal assembly? And we have two variants of this question because we can consider both the strong sticking rules or the weak sticking rules. Now, if you think about this problem for a few seconds, you actually quickly realize that this is exactly equivalent to asking the question, does the given tileset admit a tiling of a bi-infinite snake or an infinite snake-shaped region on the plane? So this is an example of an infinite snake on the plane. So formally, we have just an enumeration of some positions on the plane in such a way that the consecutive positions are neighbors, and this shape does not intersect itself. So the snake is not allowed to intersect or overlap with itself. All right, and then we tile these snakes. So we can do, and we have, of course, two different kinds of snakes. We have the strong snakes. So we put the Wang tiles on the snake, and we require that any two neighboring tiles that are on the snake must match in color, even if they are not consecutive in the snake, just if they are neighboring. So this is an example of a strong snake because the colors match even here, where the snake just comes back and kind of touches itself and then goes away. And then we have the weak snake, where we only require the consecutive positions to match, like here. You see, we are allowed to have mismatch here when the positions are not consecutive on the snake. And so the snake tiling problem simply asks, given a set of tiles, does it admit an infinite snake? A strong tiling of an infinite snake or a weak tiling of an infinite snake? Two questions. And as I said, you can very easily see that these are equivalent to the termination problem in self-assembly, because if you can assemble, if your tiles admit an unbounded growth, then in that assembly you will actually have a valid tiling at infinite snake, as you easily see. And if your assembly rule was strong, then the snake also must be strong, because the tiles must always match with any other tiles that are part of the assembly. So that's how we get to the snake tiling problems. Now, actually, the snake tiling problem was asked already before this self-assembly motivation was proposed. So there was a paper in 94 by Harel and others, where they exactly in the conclusion they asked as a main open problem the question, is it decidable if a given tile set admits an infinite snake? So our answer is that this is an undecidable question. It was actually the conjecture also in this paper that it should be undecidable. So how do I reduce the domino problem in the snake tiling problem? So I will show you the idea. In the reduction, I will use one particular tile set. So this is one fixed tile set that I use in the reduction. I call it the snakes. Okay, there are a lot of snakes in this talk, but so this is the one specific tile set with one particular property that I need. So the snakes tiles are Wang tiles, but in addition, there is an arrow printed on every tile. And the arrow points to one of the four neighbors. And I will call this kind of Wang tiles directed tiles. And then I can define, if I have directed tiles, I can define a directed snake by requiring that I put these directed tiles along the snake and the colors match. And in addition, the arrow that I have on the tile always has to point to the next position of the snake. So the arrows tell you exactly where, in which direction you should continue from every tile to get that snake. So that's a directed tiling of a snake. And of course, we have two variants. We have the strong and weak variant, but I actually only use the strong variant here. So this would be okay. This is not okay because this red here, this arrow points the wrong direction. Okay, and this one particular tile set that I use has this following property that I will call the plane filling property. And this property states that any strong directed snake that you form with these tiles is necessarily a plane filling path. Okay, so any strong snake that follows the arrows on your tiles, the tiles match with between any two tiles that belong to the snake, they have to match in color, then this path is forced to be a plane filling path. More precisely, for every n, there has to be an n by n square that is completely visited by this path. And of course, not to have a trivial case, we also require that the snakes admits at least one perfectly valid tiling of the plane, so that we actually have an example of an infinite plane filling snake. So this tile set, I'm not showing you the construction of this tile set, it's rather complicated. It is based on an aperiodic tile set by Robinson that we decorate by adding these directions to tiles and some additional constraints, color constraints on the sides. The paths that this tile set necessarily define on any correctly tiled snakes have the shape of this well-known Hilbert curve. So if you follow the arrows, you will get something like this for bigger and bigger and bigger. You are forced to follow this path if there are no tiling errors on your path. All right. So now I just first prove the undecidability of a kind of a intermediate variant of the snake tiling problem, which is we get now immediately, which is a directed snake tiling problem. So now the input to the problem is a directed tile set, and you ask, does it admit a strong directed snake? And here is the proof of a construction or reductions from the reduction from the domino problem. So suppose that you are given a Wang tile set T that you want to know whether it tiles the plane or not. So that's the input to the domino problem. Now I just construct a new tile set which are directed tiles by making a Cartesian product of the given tile set T that you want to know if it tiles the plane together with my snake tiles. So this is a sandwich tile. You have two layers. And the matching rule is that both layers have to match. Okay? So if you you look at the both layers, and the colors have to match on both layers between neighbors. And the direction is given by the direction of the snakes. And I claim that this tile set, the sandwich tiles, admit a strong snake, admit a valid tiling of the snake, if and only if the tile set T that you gave me admits a valid tiling of the plane. And the proof is really trivial. One direction is immediate. If the tile set T that you gave me admits a valid tiling of the plane, then the sandwich tiles also admit a valid tiling of the plane. You just take the, on the lower layer, you just take the tiling by T, and on the upper layer, you make the tiling with the snakes, and then you have a strong snake there. The converse direction is the more interesting one. So suppose that your sandwich tiles admit a snake, valid snake, and then let's look at this snake S. It's valid on both layers. Remember, we have two layers, and the tiling is valid on the snake on both layers. So the plane filling property of the upper layer guarantees that the only possible shape that your snake can have is this plane filling path. That was the property of my snake tiles. So your path is necessarily a plane filling path, but then along the path there's no tiling error on the lower layer either, which means that the lower layer must be able to tile arbitrarily big squares, because it must be able to tile in such a way that there is no tiling error along that snake. So there are no tiling error on these bigger and bigger squares that the snake is forced to cover. So T admits a tiling of the plane. And that's it. That's proof that the reduction works. And so the directed version of the snake tiling problem was proved undecidable because the domino problem is undecidable. All right, but this was not the question that we were interested in. We were interested in the undirected variant. So we are interested to know whether, given a set of undirected Wang tiles, do they admit the tiling of a snake? And moreover, we were also interested in the weak condition. So we were interested to know whether the tiles admit the tiling of the snake of an infinite snake where we only require the consecutive tiles to match, and we don't require anything on two tiles when the snake comes back and touches to a neighborhood of its previous positions. And for this reduction we use a technique that we call these motifs. So it's a reduction from the directed version. So let D be any given set of directed tiles. I will call them macro tiles for the obvious reason, as you will see in a moment, that they are big. So this is the input that you would like to know whether it admits a directed valid strong snake. And I will effectively construct a set of undirected tiles that admit weak and strong snakes if and only if D admits strong snakes, directed snakes. And I will call these Wang tiles that I construct mini tiles for the obvious reason, as you will see, that they are small. And the construction that we use, we call it a motif construction, and it kind of realizes two goals. First of all, we get from directed tiles to undirected, and we get from the strong sticking requirement that we had in our previous proof to the weak sticking condition. And it's actually very simple, the idea. So these are the directed tiles that we want to know if they admit a strong snake, macro tile. We will associate to it a very, very large number of mini tiles that are such that they only clue. So you have this huge number of mini tiles and you have as many different colors, so that each tile deterministically clues to the next one, so that you are forced to make this shape that follows kind of the contours of your big macro tile. So this is a basic shape of a motif. I'll later modify it a little bit, but this is the basic shape of a motif. Now, notice that the motif has two free ends. These are the ends where the snake will enter this motif and exit the motif. The exit direction has to be, of course, the same as here, because we want to exit to the direction of the arrow. We don't know what was the entry direction of the snake when it came to here, so we actually need three variants of this motif, one for each possible entry direction. Okay, so this is the shape of the motif again. You have here, the red ones are colors that don't match with any other tile. So they are kind of slippery edges, they don't attach to anything. And so these motifs glue to each other only on these free ends. And the idea is that if you have a snake, well, this is not a valid snake because it's a mistake, but anyway, if you have a snake that follows the macro tiles, you can obtain a snake with mini tiles just by just by replacing each macro tile by its motif. Okay? So you will get the corresponding snake with the mini tiles. Now this obviously is not yet enough, because there is no condition given about the color matching between the edges. These were just motifs without any simulation of the colors of the macro tiles. So we need to do something to make sure that we can build such a sequence of motifs only when we have a matching of colors in these macro tiles. Like here, they should not match because these colors are wrong. So we should not be able to do this. So how do we prevent that? The only thing that we can do is to use the fact that the snake is not allowed to overlap itself. So what we do is that we introduce bumps and dents on the sides of the motifs. Okay? So on the motifs, we change them a little bit so that the final motifs will look like this. So you have a bump on the northern side and the east side, and you have a dent on the south and the west side. And they are such that the bump exactly fits in the dent. And there is a unique position on this edge corresponding to each color that you have in the macro tiles. So the position of this bump simulates the color of that macro tile. Okay? So, now, if you have two motifs that come to next to each other along that snake, if the colors of the macro tiles match, like here, everything is fine. The bump fits exactly inside the dent, the snake doesn't overlap itself, and we get the corresponding snake with the mini tiles. On the other hand, if you try to put two motifs that correspond to two tiles with non-matching colors, you would get an overlap, and so this snake would not be valid anymore. And with this very simple construction, we got from the directed tiles a corresponding set of undirected tiles that admit a weak snake, even weak snake, because we only considered matching of consecutive tiles and the geometric constraint that the snake does not overlap itself. So we see that both the strong and the weak snake tiling problems are undecidable, and therefore also the termination problem must be undecidable of self-assembly, both in the weak sense and in the strong sense. So this work was actually, I should mention, I didn't put here the bibliographic references. This work was done in collaboration with Len Adelman, Lila Kari, Dustin Reishus, and Peter Sosik. Okay, so now let me look at a related question. Somewhat similar looking question about paths and tilings of paths on the plane. And so you might ask the following question. What about building loops with the given tiles? So you have a given set of tiles. Is it possible to put them next to each other so that they form a correctly tiled loop? The shape of the loop is, of course, not given as part of the input. Just you ask, is it possible to make a loop with these tiles? And okay, we have different variants. We have a strong loop, where we require that even the non-consecutive positions of the loop must match in color. And we have the weak loop, where we only require that the consecutive ones match, but they don't need to match here. And then we have a directed loops, strong and weak. So really four possible variants as with the snakes. And the decision problems, yeah, okay, there are four variants of them, but they are all undecidable. Does a given set of tiles admit a tiling of the loop, of some loop? And again, now I want to point out the difference similar to what we had in the domino problem and finite domino problem in the direction of semi-decidability of these snake and loop tiling problems. For the snake tiling problem, the negative instances have a semi-algorithm for it, because you can just try to make big, longer and longer snakes, and if you find n, so that it's not possible to make a snake of length n, you know that it's a negative instance. So they are semi-decidable. Whereas for the loop tiling problem, the positive instances are semi-decidable, because all you have to do is to find that loop. Try longer and longer loops until you find the correctly tiled one. So we have here a similar difference in the direction of semi-decidability, which also suggests the how we prove this loop tiling problem undecidable, namely we reduce the finite tiling, finite domino problem into it. And I think I can go pretty fast this because through this, because this is a very similar technique that we used for the snakes, but the difference is that instead of my special tile set snakes that had the plane filling property, I loop another special tile set called loops that have a rectangle filling property, or rectangle covering property. And this is what I call a rectangle covering property. This loop tile set has the property that any strong loop that you make with them necessarily covers a rectangle, such that on the boundary you have green tiles and in the interior you have a single you have a blue tile. So I forgot to mention that my loop tiles are partitioned into three parts. We have uncolored tiles, we have blue tiles, and we have green tiles. Okay, three different parts. And this has this property that no matter what strong loop you take with these tiles, the only kind of loops that you can make always have to cover a rectangle with green boundary and something blue inside it. And the construction of this loop tileset is very similar to the snake tileset, so just a little modification. Actually, these loops will have this kind of the shape of the Hilbert curve, except that you close it so that it becomes a loop. And the closing is achieved by this blue tile in the center. All right, and then to prove the loop tiling, the directed loop tiling problem undecidable, we do exactly the same construction. We do the sandwich. So we have this special tile set loops. We have a tile set T that you want to know whether it admits a finite tiling of the plane, tiling with only a finite number of non-blank tiles. You make sandwich tiles, but now you add a small constraints on what kind of pairs of tiles you accept as sandwiches. The idea here, let me go back. So the idea here is that on the blue tile, we want to use this blue tile to guarantee that there is something non-blank on the lower layer, and the green tiles we use to guarantee that you have it's surrounded by blanks, what you have on the lower layer. So the constraint that we make on the pairs that we take in that we accept as sandwiches is that if this is a green tile, a boundary tile, then T has to be blank, so that we force blanks on the boundary of the rectangle. And if L, the upper layer tile, is blue, so it's in the center of that rectangle, then the lower layer tile is required not to be a blank, so we don't allow it to be blank. So these are we remove some sandwiches so that these constraints are satisfied. And now we have exactly the same proof as for the snakes. So the sandwich tiles admit a strong directed loop if and only if the tileset that you gave me admit a finite tiling of the plane with finite number of non-blank tiles. and the proof, I just give it as pictures. So for one direction, suppose that the tileset that you gave admits a finite tiling. So this is the non-blank part of that finite tiling. Well, you just overlay on the top layer. That will be your bottom layer. On the top layer, you put a big enough loop that completely covers this your finite region. You position it so that the blue tile goes on top of the yellow part and the green tiles go outside of it. That is a valid strong loop with the sandwich tiles. And conversely, suppose you have a valid loop with the sandwich tiles by this rectangle covering property. It has to be covering some rectangle, green rectangle with something blue in the middle. And now the restriction on our sandwich tiles. Okay, this stopped working. Now it's too far. All right. There we go. So for the other direction, we see that the constraints that we made on the sandwich tiles force here to be something non-blank, here to be something blank, and therefore, and everything inside has to be correctly tiled because it's part of the loop. Therefore, clearly, T admits a finite tiling. So it was a reduction from the finite domino problem. All right, so the directed loop tiling problem in the strong variant is undecidable. And using our motif construction exactly as I described it, without any changes to it, we can get rid of the directions to get the undirected loops, and we get rid of the strong matching condition to go to the weak matching condition. So that all the different variants can be shown undecidable with that same motif construction. All right, so in the title I promised some recursive inseparability results. So let me mention the first one here. So first of all, just to remind you, what does recursive inseparability mean? We say that two sets, A and B, are recursively inseparable if there is no decidable set or recursive set that would completely contain A, but who's outside, such that B would be completely its outside. So we cannot partition the space into two recursive sets, one containing A, one containing B. And it is known that they are recursively inseparable sets that are recursively enumerable. We will use that in a moment. And now, it turns out that the two proofs that I gave you, one for the infinite snakes and one for the loops, we can combine them into a single proof so that we actually get a recursive inseparability result. This is not very natural looking inseparability, but it will later on give another one for cellular automata. So I claim that these two sets of Wang tiles are recursively inseparable. On one side, we have those tile sets that do not admit any kind of loops and do not admit any kind of snakes, infinite snakes. And on the other side, we have those tile sets that admit both kinds. So they admit arbitrarily long loops, and therefore they also admit infinite snakes. And there is no way to recursively separate them. There's no decidable set that would partition the space of tiles in such a way that these would be on different sides. And I'm not going to give the detailed proof, but just the idea. This is the proof. It goes exactly as the other two proofs, just merged together. Instead of my specific special tile snakes and loops, I will have a set combined, which has both properties at the same time. It has the plane filling property and it has the rectangle covering property. So any infinite snake necessarily is plane filling, and any loop is necessarily rectangle covering. So it covers a green bordered rectangle with something blue inside. And we use that and we make a sandwich with it. But now we do a kind of a more choosy sandwich because we have three layers on our sandwich. We have two tile sets. One, so we go as follows. We pick these two arbitrary sets A and B that are recursively inseparable and are recursively enumerable. You just fix your favorites. They are fixed. And now for any given X, any given potential member of A or B, we can effectively construct two tile sets. First tile set is such that it admits a finite tiling if and only if X belongs to A. That's because the finite tiling problem is RE complete. So we have a conversion. If X belongs to A, because A is RE, then this tile set admits a finite tiling. And another tile set where we use the reduction to that was used to prove the domino problem undecidable. So if X is in B, if and only if the second tile set admits no infinite tiling, because the no infinite tiling case is RE complete. And we just make this sandwich with them. And now it's easy to see that if X is in A, then both layers have to admit valid tilings, so that these sandwiches must admit both snakes and loops. And if X is in B, then neither layer admits a valid tiling, and therefore the special property of the top layer prevents the snakes and loops from existing. And since these two are recursively inseparable, then these two cases, no loops, no snakes, and both loops and snakes must be recursively inseparable. All right, so that finishes my first application, which was self-assembly. Let me then go to the second one, which will be shorter, I think. So I will talk about cellular automata. Now, I think probably all of you know the definition of cellular automata, but let me just remind you briefly. So cellular automata are very popular to use models that are used in physics to model various physical systems. In computer science, you can view them as models of massively parallel computation. And also in mathematics, they are quite interesting as they are the endomorphisms of the full shift. And just to remind you what is a cellular automaton, the simplest way to do it is to remind you that the game of life is a cellular automaton. So in a game of life, of course, you have an infinite square grid where each grid is either black or white, and these represent alive or dead. You have discrete time steps. At discrete time steps, all the squares, which are the cells, look at the eight surrounding ones and count how many living cells I have in my neighborhood. And based on this number, they determine whether they should be alive or dead in the next time step. And all cells update their state, life or dead, simultaneously. So it's a synchronous system. And in the particular case of game of life, the rule is the following. So if the cell itself is alive, it stays alive if it has two or three living neighbors, otherwise it dies. And if a cell is dead, it becomes alive if and only if it has precisely three living neighbors. So starting, for example, from this configuration with four living cells, this would be the next configuration because there are some newborn cells, but then there's some overcrowding, too many neighbors, they will die, and so on. You get this evolution of configurations, which is very complex, can be very complex. In fact, it can do universal computation also. So in more generally, a two-dimensional cellular automaton of a finite state set S is this square, infinite square grid where each cell is assigned a state. Then there is a local update rule that based on your neighbors, what you see in some neighborhood around you, doesn't need to be necessarily the exact neighbors. Maybe you are allowed to look two cells away or three cells away, but some bounded neighborhood. Based on what you see in your bounded neighborhood, you determine your next state. And you synchronously update. So you get this kind of function that changes configurations into new configurations, and then you iterate it to get the dynamics. All right, and now we say that the cellular automaton is injective if the mapping is one-to-one, which means that no two configurations can have the can go to the same configuration in the next time step. It's surjective if every configuration has at least one pre-image, so there are no so-called Garden of Eden configurations. Garden of Eden configurations are those that have no pre-images. And it's bijective, obviously, if every configuration has precisely one pre-image. Right? Kind of obvious definitions. Then we say that the cellular automaton is reversible if there is another cellular automaton that computes its inverse map. So that runs the cellular automaton backwards in time. Okay. So of course this requires that the cellular automaton has to be bijective, but moreover, we now require that the inverse time direction is also computed by a cellular automaton. And we say that these two automata are then inverses if each other, one going forward in time, the other one backward. And now it's actually it's a important result by Curtis, Hedlund and Lindon, or it's a corollary to a more general theorem, that every bijective cellular automaton is in fact reversible. So if your map is bijective, then you have the inverse map, and the inverse map is always computed by another cellular automaton. So the statement really says that if you have a bijective CA map, every cell, of course, can determine its previous state, but to do so, it only needs to look at some bounded neighborhood around it. All right. And now it's also very easy to actually, it's very easy to see that injectivity always implies surjectivity in the setup of cellular automata. So we have this picture that we have this cellular automata that are reversible, which are equivalent to injective and bijectivity, and they are included in this bigger class of cellular automata, which are the surjective ones. And then you have those that are not even surjective. And we have, of course, the corresponding decision problems. So you give me a two-dimensional cellular automaton and you ask, is this reversible? Is it bijective? Is it injective? I mean, that's the same question. And then you have the second question, is this surjective, this cellular automaton that I have? And both problems are undecidable. Okay. Now, okay, this is a kind of look similar remark as before. So the direction of semi-decidability is a kind of opposite in some sense. So in the case of the reversibility question, it's the positive instances that are semi-decidable. You can recognize the reversible, I mean, there's a recursive enumeration of reversible CA. You just try all possible cellular automata one by one, and then you check, is this the inverse rule, the one that takes you back in time? That gives you a semi-algorithm. But for the surjectivity problem, it's the other way around. They are the negative instances that are semi-decidable, because all you have to do is to find a finite pattern that has no pre-image. Okay, so this, I guess, suggests what we do. We do the reductions from the snake and the loop tiling problems, actually directly. So I claim that, in fact, the reversible cellular automata and the non-surjective ones are recursively inseparable. So not only they are undecidable, we have the stronger results that they are recursively inseparable. And the proof is actually very direct reduction from the snake and loop tiling problems and the inseparability that I showed concerning them. And this is my reduction. So you give me any Wang tile set T that you want to know if it admits loops or snakes. I construct a cellular automaton out of it. I make a cellular automaton whose states have three components. You have one of the tiles from your tile set. Then you put an arrow. The arrow can point any direction. It's free. And then you put a bit. So to take this whole Cartesian product. These are the states of your CA. For any cell, it has some state like this. We say that the follower cell is the one that is pointed to by this arrow. So you have this arrow on the cell. It points to one of the four neighbors. That's the follower. And we say that this cell is an active cell if and only if it matches in color with its follower. That's a definition of an active cell. And the local rule of the CA is the following. If the cell is inactive, like here, so it does not match with its follower, then it doesn't do anything. It does not change its state. So this remains as it is. If the cell is active, like here, it matches with the follower, it only changes its bit. And it does the following with the bit. It does the XOR operation with the bit that it reads from the follower. So it adds modulo 2, the bit from here, to its current bit. So here it would add, because this is active, it would add 1 to it, so it would become 1. Okay? So that's the local rule of the CA. Very, very simple. And now I claim that if your tileset admits a weak loop, then the cellular automaton is not surjective. Easy. Suppose you have a weak loop like here. This is a weak loop. I can easily exhibit you a pattern that has no preimage under the CA rule. I just put the arrows in such a way that they follow this loop. I put bit 0 everywhere except in one place where I put 1. You see, all the cells are active. All the cells would perform the XOR operation. Therefore, in one time step, you would necessarily have an even number of 1s. No matter what bits you have here one time step before, you do XOR everywhere, you necessarily have an even number of 1s next time step. Therefore, you cannot get this particular pattern as an image. So, the CA is not surjective. And the other direction is also very easy. So, suppose that the CA is not reversible, then we have two different configurations that have the same image. They must have a different bit somewhere. What does it mean? It has to be active. So it matches with the follower. The follower must have a different bit in them, because otherwise the XOR would give you a different result in them. Then you can repeat the reasoning in the follower. They must be active. The next tile, I mean, in the next cell, you must have a different bit, and they must be active, and so on. You keep on doing. What you are defining is either a loop or a snake. Weak loop or a snake, necessarily. So we see that we prove these implications. If your tileset admitted loop or and snake, then it was not surjective, the CA. If it had no loops or snakes, then the CA is reversible. These are exactly the two conditions that we showed to be recursively inseparable, so these two conditions have to be recursively inseparable as well. Right? All right, so finally, my conclusion slides. So we proved that this recursive inseparability, which means that any property of two-dimensional cellular automata that lies between reversible CA and surjective CA has to be undecidable. So you cannot, there can be no algorithm to decide it. And there are several such properties that have been considered in the CA literature. These are topological properties like openness, closingness. There actually has been a paper proving the undecidability of closingness. Well, it actually comes now directly from this recursive inseparability. This is interesting, this third property, density of periodic orbits, which is related to chaoticity of cellular automata. This is a famous open problem in cellular automata, whether it is true that every surjective CA has dense periodic orbits. But we certainly know that every reversible CA has dense periodic orbits, so we know that this property is for sure undecidable. I don't know anything about this conjecture, this famous open problem, whether it's true or false, but for sure I know that density of periodic orbits is undecidable because it lies between reversibility and surjectivity. And it would be interesting maybe to sharpen this result, to shrink these classes a bit further, to get some other natural smaller classes that would be recursively inseparable, to see how far we can push this. All right, thank you.